carrying on with Season 2, Nerds, Jocks, and Preppies. I am 8th Dan Stanadu, happy to be here to talk about Screwballs 2, Loose Screws. Oh, this is a great, great movie, one of my favorites of all time. So I am happy to welcome my partners in crime, so to speak, my partners in craziness. All right, Nick, how you doing?
I'm doing what? Greetings and salutations. I'm doing awesome. I am just a little confused tonight because I watched Loose Screws. Is this a sequel?
It is a great movie.
I was unaware that this movie had any connection to Screwballs officially.
It's a thematic sequel. It's like the Fast and the Furious.
But
it's like the Tokyo Drift.
At any time, was this marketed as Screwballs too?
Yes.
Yes, it was. On the poster. All right.
On the poster, marketed as Screwballs 2, along with the phrase from some critics saying, boobies galore.
So, in other words...
Not making that up.
It's right up our alley. So, we already know that they're here. So, say hello to Jim and Jack.
Hi, this is Jim, and I want to say a big hello to all of my fellow alumni from Beaver High.
And you've gone to a lot of schools, Jim.
I moved around a lot as a youngster.
I do like how they did not punctuate that joke whatsoever. just put the sign up there and let it go.
That's it. Yeah, but that's not where they actually go. That's where they get kicked out of or so.
That's right.
Where do they actually go? You mean you didn't end up at Cockswell Academy?
No, thankfully, just the one semester at Beaver High.
Okay.
I just assumed that you got stuck at Cockswell Academy there, Jack.
More than once.
Well, especially if you're watching this movie, because it'll help with that. Okay, Nick, why don't you tell us all about Screwballs 2, Loose Screws?
I would absolutely love to, but I can't. Wow. Loose Screws. You know what? This is sort of exactly the same movie as we watched last week, only about 30% more Canadian and 20% shittier.
fuck you.
Whoa.
Wow. I mean, it is hardly
Shots fired.
The same movie. These are
come on. We have the French teacher. We have the four guys trying to get laid.
Yes, there was no French teacher in the other movie.
There is a French teacher in the other movie.
There's a French teacher in both movies.
Yes, there is.
But not as a major character.
Not as a major character.
No. We have the doctor breast exam going on in both movies. There are several scenes that are carbon copies in both of these movies.
Give me a second scene that's a carbon copy then.
I just gave you three.
No, you didn't. You gave a character. You said, oh, there's a French teacher and there's a French teacher.
There's the French teacher who's talking all sexy in front of the class.
And he said the breast exam. That's
the breast exam.
That's like 5 minutes out of an 80-minute movie.
Okay, the breast exam I'll give you. I don't think that there's that's not the same.
No. It is exactly this. The scenes are.
Okay,
So the big difference in this movie seems to be that our four heroes are on probation, I think, at Beaver High, and they have to go to some sort of academy or reform school.
Summer school, essentially.
Summer school, yes. It's never really clear how this school is, you know, more strict than a regular school. Guys, put that thing away.
Rain running through your room there?
That would be the thunder.
Are you hungry or thunder? That's amazing. That's some great sound effects.
Whose place was that at?
That's at my place.
Wow. Dude. Glad I don't live anywhere close to you. For many reasons.
So our four heroes arrive at this new academy, and instead of, you know, buckling down to graduate, they decide they really need to, I believe the term is, ravage as many women as they possibly can before they get kicked out. And that's the movie.
For which they develop a points system.
Yes. Yeah. You know what? That's really not as well developed as I would have liked. I would have liked, you know, a running score throughout the movie, maybe a scoreboard on the bottom. I had trouble keeping track on who was ahead.
I don't think they – well, apparently at one point they all managed to reach the exact same score. Not completely sure how they managed to do that. But, you know, given that two of them could pretty much score at will and two of them could pretty much not score ever, I'm not sure how they managed to do that. Yes, it would have been great to have their scoring system, but at a certain point, you know, it came down to they all had to go for the big fish, which was Mona Lott, the French teacher. So yes,
the point of this is now that Nick there has given an awful synopsis of this movie, Stan, as one of your favorites, give a proper synopsis of this awesome film.
All right. Well, this is a movie where, of course, you know, four put upon students who are perhaps, you know, the worst students in Beaver High.
How are they put upon? They're awful students and not very good people.
They are great people. They are fine people who are just looking out for all the women in their world. Fine people. And anyways, so these four gentlemen, Brad Lovett, Steve Hardman, Hugh G. Rection, and Marvin Eatmore, they were forced by their evil principal to go to Cockswell Academy, and they wind up under an even worse principal, Principal Arsenault. And, you know, that's where they meet Mona Lott, the French teacher, who Principal Arsenault has absolutely got his eye on. And so in this case, they do have their game for whoever gets to score the most points in the sex game kind of thing. And from there, the hilarity ensues leading up to the school's anniversary celebration when everything comes to a climax.
Now, now maybe you guys can clarify this for me. Now, the principal of Beaver High, was that the same principal that we had in Screwballs? They both had this Bill Murray-esque vibe, but
I actually wrote down that the principal was the winner of the Bill Murray 30 years later lookalike contest.
Yeah, I knew it was Bill Murray because it's Bill Murray now, not Bill Murray then.
Yeah, that's right.
No, because this was Principal Hardbutt. The other one was Principal Stuckup.
Principal Stuckup.
It's the same actor, I think, is what he's asking.
Stuckup, oh, fuck off.
It was not the same actor.
It was not.
Oh, I just got the
yeah,
thunder.
Yeah, these movies are completely different.
I just heard thunder, which means that people who are trying to triangulate our secret hideouts can now work out the distance between.
Distance between our houses. Excellent.
Okay, I've got a question about Principal Arsenault. So every character in this movie, even more so than Screwballs, every character in this movie has a double entendre name, like Marvin Eatmore and Nikki Nystroke. Is Arsenault supposed to be a funny name? Like, it's a common enough name, but is it meant to be funny? Like, it's Arsenal?
Yeah, that's right. The way they pronounce it, like, I would think it was Arsenault, but they pronounce it Arsenal, which is kind of odd. Yeah, I don't know if there is something. I don't know what it would be. Unlike, say, you know, the teacher Hilda von Blow, where that's pretty safe.
Or the student who actually manages to get paged over the loudspeaker or as Hugh G. Rection.
Oh yeah, I mean that is
middle initials ever been used on an announcement. But
yeah, that is the most obvious name. I mean, you've got Tracy Greathead in there as well, which is
that's my favorite, Tracy Greathead. Fuck yeah.
I mean this movie, because okay, so I'll give you this one, Nick. You know, I mean, this movie starts out with the breast exam. This time, though, it's instead of being done by, I guess, the jock character, it's the preppy character who gets to perform the breast exam. So you know, totally different. And yeah. as you mentioned last episode for Screwballs, as was mentioned last episode for Screwballs, this is the one where the girl doesn't have the bra and is forced to but is still allowed to undergo the breast exam.
He's a kind person.
Very, very kind. One of the things that I'll say that's freaky about this one is that this one also features some male nudity, because there's this great moment at the top where like the bus is driving in. Actually, oh my god, this movie's chock full of great moments.
Yes, it is.
The bus pulls in, and our four heroes, one of them decides, oh man, I know what we're going to do. So he goes and he starts welcoming the women in, and so he tells the women to go to one room and the guys to go to another room. And of course, so the women get pushed towards the breast exam, and the guys get pushed towards their exam, which of course is the women's washroom, which so of course hilarity ensues there.
It's the staff faculty room, I think, or something like that.
Okay.
It is a washroom.
It is a change room.
Yeah, some sort of change room. Yeah.
But there's a moment where they're drive. This is one of my favorite scenes in the entire
what
movie.
I'd like to point out, by the way, all these guys, they just took off all their clothes. They're just hanging around each other, hands over their dicks, just like waiting for somebody to show up. Normal. And then none of them just go and beat the fuck out of these guys afterwards.
Well, like, they didn't know.
You would think that these guys would be hunted down and just killed for this. But no repercussions.
Everybody loves these guys except for the principal. Let's be honest. I mean, because they're the good old fashioned ne'er-do-wells.
Okay, so it wasn't a mean joke. Why would you get mad over that? If that happened to me, I think I'd think it was funny. I wouldn't be standing around with other guys just sort of waiting to be discovered.
This is a real bygones big bygones kind of school, though. So yeah. Each of the guys takes their moment trying to make a play for Miss Mona Lott, or at least see some boob. As we said in Screwballs 1, get a glimpse of boob, get a glimpse of tit, is what they said. So each of them gets their shot. Each of them gets caught taking their shot, trying to sneak a peek at this woman naked. And after the fourth one happens, the principal says, this has really got to stop. I mean, one more time and you guys are out, after they've broken into her house and set up cameras and smashed up the gym locker room trying to spy on her.
Well, let's face it. He is planning to do almost exactly the same thing, only the 10th degree. He is trying to sexually extort this poor woman.
Mm-hmm.
And
so this poor woman is certainly not being sexually extorted by him. She's like, hey, whatever it takes to get ahead of my career. Yeah. That is the character.
She's an interesting character, because at the beginning you have this feeling like, oh, she's just an innocent French teacher. And then there's at a certain point you totally realize, oh no, she actually doesn't care about the fact that this guy is married and she's just in it to win.
Like at all.
So I mean, okay, it's fair to suggest that it has a, you know, like, sure, there's a scene where where his wife, of course, because he doesn't want to screw his wife, apparently.
No, because she's only gorgeous.
Yeah. So.
No, his wife says no. His wife says that just once a semester. That's how often he gets it. So he's frustrated.
She'd rather have the student who teaches tennis. Which is great.
just throwing this out. Do you think he knew the kid was in his bed when he mentioned the athletic socks?
No.
Okay. I thought maybe he was, you know, okay. He didn't even care at that.
So there is one point where the preppy is going to have sex with this woman who he has picked up at the tennis, giving her tennis lessons.
It's at
He's
the
back
school.
In her house.
that he
is it actually meets. At school?
Yeah, because she's there with Principal Arsenault, and she gets bored because he's kind of a boring
guy. Oh, that's
guy.
Right. Yeah,
and
yeah.
So she wanders off, and that's when our hero finds him, or finds her.
So yes, of course, the twist is that it is the principal's wife, and he almost gets caught, and then nothing for that plot line happens for the rest of the movie.
Nope, she gets forgotten about. She says she like
it's one line at the very end.
Yeah, it's fantastic though, because she like chases him around the room after he realizes who she is, and eventually he gets like tossed, like he falls out of the bedroom window down two flights, and like doesn't hurt himself at all, which is great. This is like you think about it, and when I think back to like Jocks or something like that, this is. It has elements that I think Jocks may have wanted, but this is the movie that really takes them and makes it work.
Oh yeah. Yeah. The humor here works. And then it also has a certain breeziness to it and fun thing about it. And it's does have some nudity.
Yeah. In fact, I mean, the nudity starts pretty quick. There's an awesome, awesome little scene right off the top. They're driving their convertible to get to Cockswell Academy, and our one character has a shirt that says "Wanna trade?" And so he shows that off to all the women that are driving by in the other cars, and so the first one is like, "Nope, not gonna happen." Next card. Oh, sorry.
Go ahead. Nope, go ahead.
So then the next card drives up. And this one woman with very large breasts, you know, also stands up in the car, you know, pops the sweater off, and her shirt says sure, and so they trade. But
okay, the first one it wasn't going to happen. It's that she stood up and was pregnant.
Oh yes, that's right. Yeah, and so then the next one, her shirt says sure, and that
of course it is.
That is great, and then of course you see him wearing the sure T-shirt for the rest of the rest of that scene. So I, you know, what it was a great way to introduce you to the characters and to this movie,
and to show some tits
and to do that.
I truly think you guys have a little bit more nostalgia goggles on this one.
Oh, come on.
Just saying, I'm not saying all the humor didn't hit, but I think your 13-year-old mind is remembering your 13-year-old mind rather than
I'm
what
only 22 years old, so I don't think so.
I laughed out loud.
Well, Jack, mathematically, that's totally fine that you could have seen this when you were 13. I was 15. Okay, fair enough.
Upon rewatching, this movie still made me laugh out loud in several places. So, I mean,
we've stopped talking about plot at all. Do we want to switch into points here?
Well,
I want to really argue this.
Well, I would like to bring up. I would like to bring up Bradina.
Yes.
This is one of those.
Okay, let's talk. Tell us about Bradina.
But this is one of those moments that it almost feels completely out of the blue, where the one where the Brad Lovett character decides, like right after they get to the school, that he's going to try to see some boobies, and so he dresses up as a woman and goes to the girls' dorm room, because really it's not like a dorm, it's just a dorm room with like 8 beds. And this is where,
well, they're not rich like the guys in Preppies.
No, that's right. I totally thought of Preppies when I was watching this movie, and you know, with like 8 beds in a room. But so anyways, he's there in the room, and the one kind girl, Candy Bar, she offers to let him sleep in her bed, and we establish that she can't see very well without her contact lenses in, and so then finally it winds up like Bradina has to go and have a bath. And this is one of those crazy scene. So, I mean, this is another great way to get some nudity in. You know, we go into the bathroom where there's a couple of bathtubs that the girls just basically filter through. And I was shocked because at no point did they ever run fresh bathwater. So it just seemed like perhaps they were all forced to bathe in the same bathwater.
Well, they said they were out of hot bathwater, remember?
That's true.
That's not the issue. The issue is that as he's leaving their room, there's a girl doing exercises, you know, touching her toes or whatever. And when he walks into the bathroom, 1 second later, that's the girl in the bathtub topless.
Little continuity problem is what you're saying.
That's... What?
Well, perhaps this movie has some continuity problems. Okay. And so
really, don't you understand twins?
It's hard to hold continuity together over 70. It's hard to hold continuity together over 72 minutes.
Yes.
It's a lot of movie
pieces. Plus, you got to keep up all the continuity from the last movie. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But Brendina and Candy in the bathtub together, you know, Brendina still wearing the bra and stuff like that with all the cotton balls.
I wrote down that Brendina is super sketchy, like a less creepy Mrs. Doubtfire.
I would have gone with Bosom Buddies, which I'm sure these guys would think was the height of comedy in that era.
One thing that I will say about Loose Screws is that where Screwballs, you know, attempted to make it appear as if it was taking place in the 1960s, there is no question that Loose Screws is all 80s. When you look at the way they dress, the way that the music is, it is all 80s. Wow.
The girls' dorm that we were talking about has a Van Halen poster. It has Billy Idol pinups. It has a Howard Jones pinup, and you don't get more 80s than that.
That's true. And Boy George.
I don't think Howard Jones was allowed to record music after 1989.
Now, well, the girl who passed out the joints, do you think she was wearing her own clothes, or was that costuming?
I'm sure it was her own clothes, to be honest with you.
Because she was distinctive in every scene she was in. Okay, as, like, 80s girl.
We were talking about how the points scoring system doesn't necessarily make a lot of sense. So the actual scoring is 10 points if you sleep with a girl. 5 for an almost. So there's a lot of wiggle room there. 5 for an almost is their phrase. 2 for a look-see. And 100 points for Mona Lott.
Well, Brad must have, just from that scene alone, Brad must have had close to like 100 points.
Yeah, indeed. There's a couple of scenes like that. But what I want to pinpoint is that's the scoring. We spend quite a bit of time with is it Marvin in this movie?
Yes, Marvin. Are you talking about the aerobics scene?
He goes to the aerobics class and gets zero points.
I have to say, this is a genius.
No, but fantastic.
That whole scene. I mean, there's lots of nudity in this movie, but I found those scenes more erotic than any other scene in this movie.
And it harkens back to some Ninja 3, The Domination.
That's right. The most erotic film ever made.
This had a V8 in it, though. It might have taken that.
Yes.
But with all the screen time, that, I mean, the aerobics is awesome. There's some really great laughs there as Marvin rolls around during an aerobics class, which is always great humor. Chubby guy in aerobics class always laughs. But he doesn't get any. He doesn't even get a. He doesn't.
Now
get
when
a
I show up at the aerobics class, they're not laughing.
But it's so awesome because it's they just play along with it. Like he's picking up women. He's like they're exercising and he's like holding them so that their crotch is like two inches from his face. It's just
Here's
a nerd alert trivia. They knocked that scene out in just one day. It's true.
That's true. That's because
Marvin, I imagine that scene was his idea.
The actor playing Marvin E. Moore is a consummate professional. Yeah, and he could just one take for the entire day.
He probably could only do one take before he had
given
to
that there's no dialogue
off
in any of those scenes. Yeah, you can roll that off really quickly.
he needed to harken back to his former character from Screwballs, Jerkovsky, and
Well, that's the thing is the characters, while two of the actors are the same, and one obviously is like the brother or something like that, they're the same characters even if they have different names, because you still got the guy who can score with all the chicks and is like the cool, slick guy. Mm-hmm. You got the preppy guy, right?
Well,
you still
got always has a tennis racket.
Yep.
Yeah. No, he doesn't always have a tennis racket in this one.
He just, does quite a lot, though.
Just
yeah.
mostly.
A lot, but not every time, not like the other one. But he has that tennis racket just to establish, and the fat guy who eats and jerks off, and the nerdy kind of creepy one. You know,
Huey is way creepier. There's no question Howie.
But it's the same. It's the same. But it is the same characters, even if they're not the same characters.
Yes.
The intention was to bring back all four actors, but they couldn't get them.
That is a shame, because Peter Callahan would have been great in this movie as well. Him as Bradina, oh, that would have been amazing.
He essentially turned Sam a chance to look at breasts and get paid for it. I don't understand.
Totally don't understand it. One of the great parts in this movie, because I typically rank, like, the greatest comedies to me in the world feature a random musical / dance number.
Oh, thank God you're mentioning this. I was unsure whether this was in this movie or the last movie. The choreographed
dreamed it.
The choreographed beach dance number. That's in this movie, right? Yes,
this is so great because it's just out of nowhere. It's just like, yeah, we're gonna go to this party. Oh, okay, great. So they go to the beach because, again, much like TNA, Beaver, or sorry, Cockswell Academy has a beach next to it too. Awesome. And,
well, it is Canada.
Yeah. And a choreographed dance number totally breaks out with everybody. And it's just like, it's some kind of version of like Dirty Dancing kind of thing. So it's really highly sexualized. And
really?
That was my feeling of it.
We're this season, we're definitely learning what everyone's fetish is.
But the thing is, and this is, I'll tell you for this right now. This is one of my what the fuck moments. Is while they have this dancing going on, it cuts away to two little kids who are just standing off to the side watching the dancing, and I'm like,
yeah, they're like. Fuck? Like they're like toddlers.
Yes,
they're like 2 years old. Yeah,
yeah. And I'm like, who the hell brought them to the party beach? You know, with the featuring the students of Cockswell Academy. That just seemed like really bad parenting right there.
I think the editor just wanted to get his kids in a movie.
Well, that's one way to do it.
It's not like they interacted or the footage looked like, you know, similar.
Okay, so
they were adorable.
All of the other things happening in that dance scene. There's also a girl who's in what looks to be a ankle length sleeping gown. So everyone else is in bikinis except for this one girl. Who's
That's never really addressed at all, is it?
Yeah, no.
Because they give her, give her a nice like shot to establish something's going on.
Yeah,
and then we never return to her.
There's probably a director's cut that's like, you know, 140 minutes, and I mean, you have to cut somewhere. Yeah. So her entire plot.
I also
plotline.
Thought there was a missing musical number there.
There's a second, there's a second at the end.
Yes, I know, but why weren't I wanted them to start singing in because it was so choreographed. You know, it would have been appropriate to have, you know, a band or something.
Oh, feels but like no, it was left over from another movie, maybe. Like they had a bunch of footage with that one actor in it, and he was like, I don't know, have them go to the beach for a bit.
and you know, and there are so many like songs in this that it almost would have made sense. And that's the thing, is that that's not even part of it. I don't like that's not really part of anybody's story either, because when you turn around and you come to huge erections part of his story to try to get Mona, his is,
I love that you're using the word story.
But like his is the really the worst idea of the lot. It's like I'm gonna get a ladder and my video camera, and I'm just gonna take video
I'm just
of
gonna
her getting undressed.
Yeah, how's that get you laid? I don't understand.
And what's worse is that he has Marvin underneath, like holding
So
the
what I
ladder.
like is that he's clearly at the top, and she opens the window and she sees him. Like he's at the top and he's filming her. And all of a sudden, when she closes the window, his fingers are on the ledge when clearly he's been further back the rest of the time. And I never saw the point where his fingers, because if his fingers had to be on the ledge, then how were his fingers there when the thing was closed? If the, you know, that far in, and it's like, so it may have been a plot continuity.
Again, continuity on a 75-minute movie is just a nightmare.
It's a bitch.
And why, and really, when you have a movie this fun, who gives a shit about continuity?
Well, I didn't.
So then Marvin's, and it was brought up earlier, Marvin's moment to try to see Mona is Hugh's idea of crawling around in the vents up top in the roof there,
it's a drop ceiling. Yeah.
No, no, no. You're giving huge reaction the wrong. It was the computer that told them to do it.
That is true. That is true. And this is one of those moments that.
Man, I wish I had a stalking computer that could tell me the easiest way to access the girls' washroom.
But to do Come it, and it was a computer that you talked to. But the crazy thing for me, and the thing that
it was
I absolutely
1986.
Love, yes. But to talk to the computer, you had to talk in a computer voice. I love the fact that it's just like, tell me how to find the girls' change room.
Of course. What do you expect? Yeah. Are you gonna talk Spanish to a person from China? Duh.
So he's up there in the rafters, and
I would if they spoke Spanish. Spanish.
That's true. If you spoke Spanish and they spoke Spanish, I suppose that's your best option, isn't it?
That would be the crossover language. Yeah, it would be make the most sense.
Well, shit.
Were you going somewhere, Stan? Stan, you were summarizing. You were summarizing the second half of the film. Go ahead.
Yeah, well, because Mona, much like Purity, apparently is a creature of habit and goes to the change room to get into the pool at the same time every day. So we got Marvin up in the rafters. He gets to see all the girls changing first. So that's. You know, that's definitely some points for Marvin.
And two then, points per girl right there. Yeah.
Yeah. And then Mona comes in, and of course he's super close to being able to see her when his weight unfortunately causes the ceiling to
weigh almost 3 pounds.
Yeah.
well, you know, and they did establish that, you know, there it was soundproofing he was laying on. So they couldn't hear him.
Yes. Acoustic. Yeah. Those acoustic tiles are amazing.
It's not like they just opened up like a little, like just enough to get your eye through. Like he basically just pulled open this whole ceiling tile.
Yes.
Just like so, 4 feet of him, 4 feet from this woman.
If anybody looks up.
Talking at regular volume.
Going great, guys.
Yeah, if anybody looks up, they see this like whispering. Fat guy out there.
He's not whispering in the least.
Fuck. Oh my god, that's awesome. I need to change some of my scores.
So now this leads the guys so this gets the guys in trouble, of course, with Principal Arsenault.
This is the second to last straw.
The second to last straw. And
after spying on half the school, they're so close to expulsion.
But all the guys, so the next scene is all the guys are in their dorm room. So, of course, you've got your great Steve Hardman, and he's there in his underwear with his tennis racket. And then, of course, you got Brad Lovett, who's there in his underwear with his guitar. And then
that scene was creepy.
Hugh,
there, in his underwear. You are underselling how small this underwear was.
It is definitely the tidy whitey underwear. And then there's Marvin in the back with a big shirt on over his underwear. So apparently he didn't feel comfortable enough just being in the scene in his tidy whiteys.
Just being in the jockey ad that the other three guys were in.
Oh man! Oh well, I'll tell you. Like, the guy who played Brad, he was more than willing to. Like, he stood up and like,
yeah,
you know, pulled.
He was. Yeah, he was. Like, he was showing off the underwear and a pair of socks.
And a pair of socks. Yeah.
And the pair of socks he stuffed into the underwear.
Yep.
And that's so kind of where that joke was going. Yeah. thanks for explaining the joke. The there. Socks, yes. case for the slow listeners. That's
it's apparently me.
Go ahead, Stan. Continue summarizing the last 20 minutes of the movie.
So then they decide
take less than 20 minutes doing it.
All right. Well, they decide that they are going they're sick and tired of not having any women right now and being confined to their room. So they figure, what's the best thing to do? They're going to escape the room, head to the strip club, and watch a wet t-shirt contest, which is a lovely wet t-shirt contest.
Why wasn't a wet t-shirt contest a modifier for this season?
A wet t-shirt contest would have been a perfect modifier. That totally, and it's a great scene. All of them get up there. Where do you find the wet t-shirt contest that means that guys have to come up and squirt whipped cream all over the girls and then lick it off?
But Principal Arsenault decides he's gonna romance
Mona Lott.
I love that twist.
Can't we go someplace else? He's like, we're going to have a great time.
I like that he insists that they go there. It's not just like he has a bad idea. No, no. He's sure that this is the right plan.
Well, they do have the best barbecue in town.
Yeah, he mentions. Yeah, that's true. All right, let's switch to scoring.
Don't we want to bring up the end really quickly? Because that's not the end.
No, okay, you've got 18 more minutes. Go ahead.
No, I mean...
Hopefully that will get us out of the summarizing part of the episode, and we can start talking about this thing.
You can talk about it anytime. Go ahead. The end... I love the end, and I remember the ending always because... So they make the statue of the founder of the school basically move and they make him audio animatronic in his own way. And this is how they managed to do the exact same thing as in Screwballs with Purity, where they managed to rip off Mona's clothes. It's a great scene. But then finally we have the guys who become a band and they perform a song, and man, that is some really terrible lip syncing.
Oh my God. But yeah, you forgot they had a video of Mona cheating with,
with that's
Chris
right.
Arsenault. That's what they're doing. So
yes,
I just actually assumed everything after the Spanish fly hit the bunch was hallucination. I did not get the statue was animatronic. I did not believe the band was a band. It was all fantasy after the Spanish fly hit the punch ball.
It's just a Hunter Thompson movie Hunter Thompson story from then on.
But it's great because Bradina makes another appearance so that they can actually get into the thing.
I'm glad they resolved Bradina.
Yep.
Gave her good. She has a more clear character arc than any other character, honestly.
Give her some closure. Okay, fine. Let's absolutely get into the scoring.
All right. We rate, in our search for the ultimate B movie, we rate our movies in five categories, none of which are objective quality. Our first category is called Schlock Appeal, and we start with Stan.
10. This is the greatest movie of all time.
I will give it a 9.
Jumping ahead.
I'm,
all right.
I'm sorry.
Premature scoring. Always a problem.
It's okay, Jack. It happens to every guy at some point.
I'm going an 8 just because Screwballs was a 7, and this seems to have an extra layer of filth on it.
I'm giving it a 9.
I'm also going. It has lots of boobs, like a lot of boobs. I'm gonna give it an 8 as well. All right, our next category we call more heart than budget.
This movie has everything. A 10.
I can't see where this is going.
Nickaroonie.
6. You can honestly say the producers went, you know what? We did it before. Let's do it again.
I would say I'm going to go with a 7. It has heart. They managed to do the animatronic thing. But I mean, it's a sequel. Anytime you do the sequel, it's hard to have as much heart as you did in the first.
With an IMDb reported budget of $1 million Canadian, I'm going to go with a 9.
$1.75 American.
Well done. Yeah. I'd have to look up the exchange rate at that point, but lousy, I think in the mid 80s. I think it was 3 American dollars per Canadian dollar at that point. So our next category, and I don't know that there's any new parts left that we can talk about, but these are the what the fuck moments.
There's a great part, and
are you kidding? Of course there is. Yeah,
there is so many, and some of these.
Here we go again.
But so there's this part, and you remember the in Preppies, the was it Preppies? All these are kind of rolling together.
They're all like
now.
One film. Now.
Oh yeah. God, he's going to recite another part of different film.
It was the cucumber farm. Was that which one was that? Was that Hots or Preppies? Which
doesn't matter.
That was Preppies.
Yes. Yes, but there's a moment in the school office where it comes on the radio and it starts talking about the most sexually frustrated men are high school principals. And of course, Principal Arsenault
is right there. That's a great line. That's a great line.
I thought that was great. This movie is loaded. I'm giving it a 10.
Nick.
Yeah, no, this movie is filled with WTFs, and I enjoyed a lot of them, but I didn't enjoy all of them. I'm going with an 8.
Okay, this, I also got an 8 on this. It's a lot. It's not at the, man, like, I love the opening. They're when they get kicked out of Beaver High and they're going to Cockswell Academy and they're taking that car ride. If you watch, you can tell they go down the same road 10 times.
It's like a Scooby-Doo cartoon. It's like
10 times the exact same road. I'm like, either they're taking the long route and just going back and forth, or
they're trolling for women.
Like, maybe this is what I've heard about that province of Saskatchewan, that it's just the same. But yeah, so I think an 8 is a good solid score for it.
All right. Well, there was a really short moment when the preppy guy is trying to get down with the principal's wife. So the principal comes home before they've gotten very far, and the student is trying to find a place to hide. He opens up the closet, and it is full of S&M gear.
Yes.
That has no explanation and doesn't tie into anything else in the film.
It's a joke,
but it does pay off.
It sort of pays off, but then they establish that the principal and his wife only have sex like 3 times a year. But I guess with this much equipment, the prep time must be a nightmare. So I'm gonna give this an 8 as well. Stan, you mentioned the little, like, there was a couple of little subtle jokes, same as there was in Screwballs, that there were some hidden gags.
Question: was it this one or the last one where they were in a adult film store? That was the last one, wasn't it?
That was the last one, yeah. Yes.
Where the guy kept walking up, like putting on a gimp mask or something like that,
How did we miss talking about that? That was so
I found that particularly disturbing when he asked for a junior SMM.
And of course, and the guy who's running the shop is just pissed that this guy's asking that he might make a sale.
Yeah.
So anyway, sorry.
So at one point, on a chalkboard.
I'm glad we fit it in here.
On a chalkboard behind, like in the, there's one of the scenes in the pool. On the chalkboard, it says that that the school that they're at, Cockswell Academy, is going to play. Has a game coming up against Pussy Willow Collegiate. right. Just so subtle, so subtle. All right, Stan, I don't know. I don't know if you're able to recall any memorable moments from this film.
I know what he's going to score it.
I am going to score it a 10, and this is a very fair number, because for 30 odd years, I have been singing Circular Impression in my head at random moments.
Circular Impression by the Extras. Oh, so yes. Great.
I've got a rubber in my wallet.
One of those little Mitch McCollins.
It's waiting for that special day. When the record comes my way. It leaves a circular impression.
Okay, one more line and we have to pay for the rights to the song. So.
Okay.
And then of course the one line to the main song, "Loose Screws Breaking Away," that I can remember, and I have been singing, like, those pop into my head, and it's happened for 30 years, so it's a fucking 10.
Oh yeah!
Wow, we always remember the first film we masturbate to. Yeah, this movie is not that memorable. I hate to break it to you.
Fuck you!
I am giving it a 5 for the soundtrack, which is fan-freaking-tastic. I love the music in this film. But other than that, watch Screwballs rather than watching this film.
We have a character named Tracy Greathead, for Christ's sakes.
Yeah, the names in Screwballs were just as good, though.
Oh, this is even better. The music. You're forgetting about all the other music of the soundtrack besides Circular Impression.
I'd give it a 0 if it wasn't for the soundtrack. 5 is generous.
You got Screw It. The dance scene at the end where they're doing the singing for no reason.
I love the music. I don't know why you're agreeing with me on this.
Yeah, the dance scene at the end or the lip sync scene.
The music is great. I'm agreeing with you. Move on.
He just wants to bring up the music.
Can I fucking say what I'm going to say, please? The music, the dance scene at the end of where the band is playing, that's just so, like, out of nowhere. And it's clearly just them trying to do, they're dressed much the same as, like, the characters in Revenge of the Nerds were dressed when they did their musical number. And it's just clearly just trying to create a moment that's memorable. And for that reason, it is. And the music is not just great, but it's not just that the music is great. It's that they found so many songs like Dance the Screw, Do the Screw, and Screw It. As well as Loose Screws. Like, you've managed to get 4 songs with the word screw in the title. We've mentioned all the other ones. Like, it's just the girl that played Mona Lott. I remember because she was also on Bizarre as one of the women who was regularly taking off her clothes. And I love Bizarre. And she was also Miss Teen Canada contestant and Miss Canada contestant. And then she actually went on to have a good career in Canada. Like, and she was on, like, 3 regular TV series and nominated for, like, their version of, what do you call it, their TV award. I don't know what that's called.
Emmy
Best Actress. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah,
it's got a familiar face. That helps. Got the great Mike McDonald, who passed away this last year at March of this year. Saw him on Arsenio Hall. Of course, this is all on YouTube because I'm only 22. Saw him on Arsenio Hall. Letterman. He was just one of the greatest stand-up comedians, probably of his generation. Not as famous as he should have been. This movie is really... It deserves the 10.
You know, Jack, I want to compliment you. You know, for a young guy, you have the B movie knowledge of a man twice your age. It is really impressive.
It speaks Bizarre to his dedication.
On YouTube, somebody should go watch it. It was a great sketch.
That's you don't play video games. That's where you get the extra time, right?
Yeah.
Kids today, video games. I wasn't playing one while we were doing the podcast or anything.
All right. I put all the points into WTF. So memorable moments. I'm only going to go with a 6 here. But
fuck you.
because again, having watched Screwballs and Loose Screws within a couple of days, I kept forgetting which scene happened in.
It's like a 2.5 hour long greatest movie ever.
Is it actually 2.5 combined?
I have trouble remembering which scene was in Star Wars and which was in Empire Strikes Back.
Yeah, but you're not that bright.
Well, I mean, you're 22. I mean, those are pretty old movies for you to be watching.
It's true.
I do love the musical numbers. I love where they put a chemical into the pool. They put about a half a liter of a chemical into an entire Olympic-sized pool that makes all of the clothing on the women disappear, dissolve. Does no other harm. That's brilliant. All right.
Isn't the scene of the aerobic scene worth the 10 by itself? One of the most memorable scenes you're ever going to see?
I forgot it was in this already.
And and you can't forget the fact that you have that Brad's character decides to give Mona a massage and does so as an Asian character.
We were coming back to that.
That was so amazing.
We're going to be coming back to that.
Bradgelina or whatever there is definitely memorable.
Oh, man.
All right, so we're moving into the last category we call crazy concept. Stan, I want you to make a case for this as a crazy concept.
All right. Well, this movie, as a continuation of Screwballs, is a little bit crazy, but I gotta give it a solid 1.
Being honest.
God bless you, Stan, for being a stand-up guy when it comes to scoring.
I wanted to find a way that you could give it a 10 so bad.
There's no way. It's the same fucking movie.
Oh, I got lambasted at the beginning of this episode, and now you admit it?
I'm not admitting it.
It's funnier to admit it now. That's fair.
That's why this is one of the best movies ever, because when you watch them back-to-back, it's like, dude, I have no idea which movie I just watched, but the truth is, I just love this movie so much.
I'll be kinder. I'll give it a 2, and I'm being charitable.
Well, I got a 4 for it because it's not that crazy concept. But just the fact that trying to score with the teacher is a little bit crazy because that's, you know. So and they seem to think they really have a chance. I mean, the preppy guy literally goes to her house to get French lessons. Here she's in the shower. She says something to us in French. He looks it up in a French to English translation, misreads it, and goes, hey, I knew she wanted it, and jumps in with her.
All right. Again, yeah, it's a sequel to a movie that I guess performed well. So I'm also going to go a 3 on this. Which brings us to our secret modifiers. Every season we have 6 modifiers, 3 pluses, 3 minuses that can be applied. Bob's your uncle. This movie has 5 of them. I'll tell you, without listing off the 6th one, it's impossible to get to get 6. 5 is the maximum you can get. So,
nobody should question how awesome this movie is now.
So, this movie is less than 80 minutes. Despite what IMDb says, this movie is only 76 minutes, I think.
Maybe there's a director's cut out there.
I looked around, but IMDb for some reason lists this as 92. I can't find a single copy. The Amazon DVD says 92, but in the write-ups it all says 76. It does have nudity in the first 5 minutes, which is next point. How many? How far in, Stan? You're an expert on this film. How far in? How first before the first nipple? We can only count nipples in this. In
it's
game.
The seventh time they went down the same road.
Yes. Yeah. So I mean, it's definitely it's within the first. It's 4 minutes.
You think 4 minutes, Nick? How far?
I am guessing 1:13.
13, yeah. Jack.
Oh no, it's definitely. I would say it's 4 minutes and 56 seconds or something like that.
Four minutes 56. Price is Right rules.
404.
Price is Right rules. You are all eliminated. It is 16 seconds.
Oh really?
16 seconds.
What? It's not the girl in the car?
No. It is a. It is. Like before there is even a line of dialogue, it's the very first shot of the film, second shot of the film after the school beef rye.
That's right. They managed to strip. He's playing a strip game of dice with her.
That's right. Man. This movie also gets a plus one for having a Mrs. Robertson. It does have the school principal's wife who invites the student back to her house. So we got a Mrs. Robinson. We also have a minus one for problematic content. So crimes aside, we also have an incredibly offensive Chinese or Asian accent of some sort. Done when he's pretending to be a masseuse, which Derek, that definitely qualifies as a
I like though that she clearly knows the masseuse, and yes. That masseuse doesn't have a mustache, but he does. He put one on to fool her. Hey, he'll think he grew this.
It's because he uses the accent, so she totally had no idea that he wasn't the Asian guy.
And Bern.
Oh, by the way, the Asian guy didn't have an accent when he talked.
Yeah, that's right. Yes,
but he's crazy. Like, don't take too long. He says that to him.
Is this crazy Fu Manchu kind of accent? And then, of course, Bernadina, which goes on a really long time. So we get a minus one for problematic content. We also, as the only movie so far this season, and I confirmed this with my wife Lacey. She was the second view. She was the second set of eyes here to confirm.
Lacey, what's her name?
Lacey Underall. There is a body double used in this film.
What?
It totally. I wasn't sure the first time I went back. It was reviewed. I got a second person, the principal's wife. She does not show any nipple until the shot. There's a single shot or two shots where he is under the blanket and playing with her nipple. She has a very, very visible tan line. The actress that is not shown under the blanket. So that's gets the body double minus one.
Oh wow!
Why that woman didn't want to show her nipples when so many others did,
and when she was more than willing to like wander around in a nightie and stuff like that and negligee,
shows no nipple.
Yep,
through the entire film, she doesn't take her bra off.
Maybe it was a pickup shot, and she already had gone on to her next acting job.
Could be,
or she might not have nipples.
It's close because there's a part where, because there's the part where he's massaging her breast,
but you can, when he's massaging her breast, you can see clearly that she has a very, very visible.
Well, if it wasn't for the tan line, as far as size and shape, good job finding a body.
That's why we use the video assisted referee.
We really should have weighted this modifier a little heavier.
This movie is still it's so great because it truly has everything.
So it'll definitely end up high on the Octagon in our search for the ultimate B movie. It comes in at a tidy 72 out of 100. Only putting it a 0.5 off of its predecessor, Screwballs.
Nice.
So very respectable numbers out of this. Weighted a little heavily by Stan's for numbers, but Stan and Jack actually really close. Stan 41, Jack 38.
There you go.
My, myself at 34 and Nick bringing up the rear at 29.
Yeah, he's usually bringing up the rear already.
Out of 50, yeah.
Some of us are booty men.
I think here. And I haven't asked you guys' opinion on this, but obviously we're going to announce the next movie. But I think now is when we should announce the next season, because I think starting now is when we should be looking for people to start giving us the feedback on what they want us to review, what seasons they want us to do, and that type of thing. What do you guys think?
Fantastic.
Sure. That sounds great.
If you're inclined.
We've already picked the next couple, but after that.
I mean, quite frankly, we can pick the next 18 and still be going strong. So.
But we want to hear from you guys, from the listeners.
All right. Well, why don't... You know, Jim, we forgot to do this last episode, but Jim, tell us where people can find us.
Absolutely. We are on Instagram at Kung Fu Electric Boogaloo. And please tell us the B movies you would like us to talk about on the show. You can use the hashtag Kung Fu Electric Boogaloo to do that. And also you can find the podcast on WeTalkPodcasts.com. They have their own Twitter and their own Facebook, so just say hi to them there.
Those guys have put us everywhere. Yeah. I appreciate that. Those guys, I mean, I still don't like them, but those guys have put us everywhere.
So yeah, and also you can subscribe to this show on iTunes. You can subscribe on YouTube.
YouTube. Kung Fu Electric. Subscribe on that website. But you know what? Yeah, I mean, what was it going to say? I can't remember. It doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter. I guarantee it. All right. Well, so anyways.
I was just going to say, not just what movies. I want to know what full seasons we should be doing. Mm. I want season ideas.
All right. Well, I guess we'll have to wait and see what the people say. All right. But I can tell them right now that the wrap-up of season two is going to be the next episode, our final episode, and that we are wrapping up with Up the Creek, another movie with a great soundtrack. So it's going to be a fun one, and I don't think anybody wants to miss it. And so then, since Jax suggested we do this, I will announce that season three, to coincide with a little bit of Halloween action. So, I mean, because season two, Nerds, Jocks, and Preppies, that coincided with school and the kids going back to school in great high school. Well, season three coinciding with Halloween is going to be our Monster Chiller Horror Theater season. And I will say that our first movie from that you can look forward to is Wolf Guy. So I am.
Well, but we will be dropping all 8 episodes this time.
That's true.
Simultaneously. We're not sure if we're going to keep doing this, but because we're wanted out there for Halloween, all 8 are going up simultaneously.
That's right. So it is going to be a major binge fest in this case. What do you think? Should I announce all of the movies?
I don't know. What do you guys think?
Why not?
All right.
What the hell? I would feel like a tease if you didn't.
There you go.
I would love to know
why not?
Movies we're watching.
If you're either going to do it, you're either doing it here or you're doing it next episode.
That's right. Okay. Well, actually, let's do it next episode because we haven't.
I think so. Yeah.
Let's make them wait for it.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Well, Wolf Guy will be the first one.
Yeah. Wolf Sunny Guy is Chiba, number baby. One. Yep. Okay. So, anyways, unless anybody has anything else to add for this,
I do. I just want to say, loose screws breaking away.
And I'll give you a dollar if you know a second line from that song.
give me a chance to watch the movie and then I'll tell you.
That'd be cheating.
I don't, well, that's what everybody does in these movies, right? All right. For Brad, who is, I don't know where the hell he was. I don't know why he wanted to miss this one. All right. For Brad, for Nick, for Jim, and for Jack, I...